Asbiro. Alternatywna szkoła biznesu i rozwoju osobowego.
Thank you very much for coming and inviting me to Poland. It's a great pleasure, and Poland indeed belongs to the countries where there is most Liberlandians per capita in the world, which I think is great. You should clap your hands for yourself for it. There is a great need for freedom in Poland, definitely, and people understand your freedom. I wonder why. Of course, it's your history. It's something that binds Liberlandian nation with Poland nation as well. And I think it's not, for example, that dense as in Czech Republic, but it's much denser than in the United States per capita. So I think Poland, I hope, will be one of the first countries to recognize Liberland. And of course, we also have here one of the best connections in politics that we have in most of the countries. So I'm grateful for you that you could come. This is, of course, one of the first lectures that I'm going to have here. And this was the first anthem of Liberland. It was actually the first out of 10 anthems that you can find now on YouTube. But my favorite is still coming. It is, I will be able to play it to you maybe at the end of this lecture. And it has been a great journey. I started this on 13th of April. Indeed, it was a significant date because it was birthday of Thomas Jefferson. Of course, we are revoking the spirit of American Revolution. This is not Exodus, this is Taxodus of modern times. This is a nation made up of the people who understand that the state has grown too big in 20th century, that there is too much regulation, that there is too much involuntary exchange between state and between citizens. And of course, 60% or more now that we pay on taxes can be more compared to the slavery than to free society. Yes, we are getting some services back from the state, but our nation believes that a state based on completely voluntary exchange could be much more prosperous. And our models, our states that we look up to is America when it was founded, might be Liechtenstein, might be Monaco, might be Hong Kong, but we still are going a little bit further than that. We are looking forward to create a country where taxes will be voluntary. They will not be 10% like in Hong Kong. They will be voluntary. And how do we want to do it, actually? We really want to limit the state to its proper role. We believe that the state should take care mainly about diplomacy, mainly about justice, and mainly about security, and nothing a part of that. And I'm actually quite happy that the author of the Constitution is Polish, Kacper Zając, you might know him. He is a great guy. I was very worried that I'm not having a constitution when I drew down to Liberland to start a country, that I was thinking I had to write a constitution before we start a country. And then 3 days after I started the country, Kacper Zając wrote me an email, I have the constitution for you. And this and this is the Polish guy who studies constitutional law at London School of Economics. He's a perfect guy to do that. And you know, just by starting, of course, the country on birthday of Thomas Jefferson, many people understood right away what we are going to create. And this is quite funny that I think so far support for Liberland and number of embassies and number of associated organizations, I think is much larger than, for example, that one of Palestine. In how fear of existence, the network that, this country has created might be larger than, maybe might be comparable to one of the Taiwan. And why is that? Because our nation is spread all around the world. So the form of the government, which is important and which we clarified with Zayats from the very beginning, it's a combination of republic and direct democracy. We picked up the best parts of American Revolution and combined it with some useful things in Swiss direct democracy, which we think also works well. And we made this very strict constitution that you can read, not only read, you can participate, you can contact Kacper, you can help him to develop the constitution. In a way, it is a good constitution, because what will happen once this constitution comes into power? It will be all very hard to change it. So we have a now version 3.0. We might have a version 9.0 or 20.0 at the end, but we have to make sure it's pretty perfect, because we decided that in the assembly body we will need unanimous decision to change this constitution. We wanted to make very sure that the constitution is rigid, that it's very hard to change. Because what we could see in other states and in US as well, that the constitution has been amended, has been twisted, and this is something that we would like to prevent. And how is it possible? Well, I studied economics, I studied political science, and I have a good friend who is very adventurous, who was helping me to develop this idea from the very beginning. How is it possible? Montevideo conventions are quite liberal in terms of creating new countries. In order to have a country, you have to have a territory, you have to have population, you have to have government, you have to have control, some sort of control over the territory. And of course, in the early stages of Liberland, we had all of these things. We were a legitimate country. When we went down there, some week after I came down there, there were already settlers from all around the world, especially from Switzerland and Denmark. But people just came down there and started to settle the country. They started to take care of the borders and so on. We, in the first week, we received something like 100,000 applications. First, we started the country because we thought that the application process can be done with email. But when we received first 100,000 applications in first week, we understood that it's not possible to be done that way. So we stopped that. We just let people register the email. And we developed proper application process. I'm just wondering, how many people here have applied for citizenship? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 15 maybe, altogether 10, 12. Yeah. Interesting. You know, we've got some 6,500 people from Poland that have registered on our website. So I hope to meet at least 5% of them during my stay here. So the response was quite crazy. So we had population, we had government, it was myself, it was my first lady, and it was my friend. We had great media coverage all around the world. We had de facto recognition by Serbia, which said they don't mind creation of Liberland, it's not formed on their territory, despite the fact that the whole world is still claiming this piece of land belongs to Serbia. Now Croatia has changed that a little bit. And we had Montevideo conventions that says directly that political existence of state is independent of recognition by other states. So we don't really care if somebody recognizes that or not. There are states like Somaliland, which has no recognition, despite the fact they are a fully functional country for more than 10 years now. Our Montevideo Convention also say that we are judicially equal to any other country, and that if anybody now obtains our territory by force, that this is not a legitimate action and should be ignored, which is also very important. If now Croatia in future will decide that they would like to get this territory, their action will be illegal. So, with this great support of Serbia, which was not recognized so much by the world media. Some of the world media said that the country, our country, is claimed by both nations, Serbia and Croatia, which is of course nonsense. We decided to start to settle it properly. So on 1st of May, I made a big group of people, and there were a couple of Polish guys as well. I hope to meet them. Was there somebody from this group? Not really. I think they're from Krakow and one is from Wrocław as well. So I hope to meet them in following days. So they went down with me to Liverland, and we knew that something is already happening, because after this statement of Serbia, Croatia got a little bit mad. They didn't know what to do, so they decided two things. They were meeting on Sunday on a secret governmental meeting where we had our person, which informed us about the meeting. And they decided on two things. First of all, they decided they will call it a joke, internal joke. And second thing, that they put around 100 policemen in the area to prevent anybody from entering. And they also kicked out our pool settlers from Switzerland and from Denmark and from Poland. They were all forcefully removed from the territory. So I decided on 1st of May, let's settle it, let's prove that we can go there and settle it. And we were stopped on the borders. I didn't want to go all the way. I just wanted to talk to the police guys that were there, explain them that they are illegally occupying our territory and so on. So I went to the borderline. I wanted to talk to them. And the journalist that was with us, there was a Croatia state journalist that was following us all the time, ran over the border to Liberland and start yelling at police guys, and they of course arrested us, despite the fact I didn't even cross to Liberland. I didn't cross any country border. And I was a little bit scared, because you know, you don't know what you are up to when you're dealing with another state. And we went down there, and the judge told me as the first thing during the trial, next day in the morning, you know, you are kind of devilish. My kids tried to go to Liberland already a week ago, and they were almost arrested. So that dissolved the very bad mood in the courtroom. And he also invited us to have a drink with him. So we had a very friendly talk with this guy. And maybe the reason for that is that, let's say he is not Croatian, right? So he is from Serbia, so he likes this issue as well as all the Serbs. And the next time we decided, okay, if this is not possible, if it's not possible to go through Croatia, if they say this is actually border between Croatia and Liberland, and they don't want to let people in, then let's go from Serbia. So we took our boats, we departed from Serbia, again with our journalist from Croatia State Television. Anyway, the first time we went there, they didn't arrest him, despite the fact he went all the way with us. But the second time, he went with us, and they arrested us all. They were a little bit more unfriendly than the first time. And when I went again to the court, there was not a regular policeman, there was a chief of the police making a case against us, insisting that we should go to jail at least for 30 days. And he was kind of angry and explaining me, you know, your Liberland is just imaginary thing, it's just in your head. And I told him, you know, Croatia is also just in your head. And that of course made him much more angry, you know, he started to shout and so on. And I told him, but I don't want to be mean. All the countries are just in our head. They are just part of our imagination. And there is no borderline in the middle of Danube that you can observe. You know, there is no middle exactly. All the institutions that we are dealing with that are taxing us to hell at make regulation, they were first of all our imagination, and they are still our imagination. They are a sort of belief system that we have made up ourselves. So I think this is one of the very important aspects about Liberland, because people realize, they start to think a little bit more about the state as it is. And I think if Liberland were to create just for that, I think it would be a successful mission, because we put this idea to all the world media that there can be a state where taxes would be voluntary and when there will be minimal regulation. We also made a large advertisement for places like Liechtenstein, Monaco, Hong Kong. We showed the people that these places prosper because there is a high degree of freedom and there is strong correlation between the degree of economical freedom and economical prosperity. So, anyway, after some half year of solving some issues and still having a little bit of difficulties, we now have a system where we can sort of follow how much energy people put in, and we are able to give citizenship to the people who collect enough Liberlandian merits. I don't know if somebody, if you applied for citizenship, now you can also see that on the website, if you have collected some, if you, for example, donated some money to the project, we exchange those money for Liberlandian merits that you can now observe on the website. We will have passports. We have to have all these things that are connected with statehood. But we are almost always trying to find the minimum amount of things that we need. So we will know, we'll have no identification cards. We'll only print passports. Why? UK also has no identification cards. There is a private initiative for stamps. For example, it's a third edition of stamps already. We now have an architectural competition, which is headed by one of the most renowned architects from Zaha Hadid. If you know Zaha Hadid, they, for example, just finished the Tokyo Olympic Stadium. They are making incredible structures. They are one of the top 10 architectural studios in the world. So on December 5th, we are starting this competition. Anybody, if you have some friends, for example, who are architects, invite them to join this, because it's very important to have some sort of visualization, have a nice picture of how Liberland could look like in future. Not only for media, but also for investors, anybody who wants to join this project. And what we actually want to do is we want to turn this urban design into a virtual city that the investors could go in, that architects could go in, add new buildings. You know, you could also see who will finance it, who will rent it, and so on, to make it as virtual in this stage as possible, but as finalized as well. This is Patrick Schumacher. It's not the racer. It's the architect. His partner at Zaha Hadid. The architectural competition is organized by Daniela, and she's also a great architect from Chicago. So they launched it in Chicago on some big architectural event. We have already some sketches how Liberland will look like. We would like to have more green stuff there than there was before. I think there will be a big green lobby fighting the development of Liberland just because we will be destroying the nature. We want to prove them wrong. We would like to show them that there will be actually more nature after we finish the project than there was before. And some of the sketches are quite nice. And this is the reality of today. In the early days, like a week after we went down there, Croatia State TV also got down there and they were making close-up pictures of this building and they said, look, this is the floor in their parliament. Look how destroyed they are, you know, they're worth nothing. So we were very fast in actually making sure that they can see how our parliament will look like and how our governmental building will look like. And just to give you a little bit of an idea, this is a place where 20 people in the assembly body will sit. We think that no more than 20 people are necessary, and 5 ministers also. This is a place where there will be a security, let's say a couple of sheriffs, one judge, one or two judges, and place for diplomacy, maybe my office that I could possibly use. But also there is an important thing that there will be no more presidents after first general election. We want to make sure that the dictatorial powers that I'm now having at this early stage will not be there after first general election, so there is no place for president in the constitution. And also, I can announce now, which is pretty good and new news, that I will now nominate two vice presidents, and I will also nominate five ministers to grow our government. It took me half year to pick the best out of the best people who applied for citizenship or who wanted to help this project. I can show you a couple of these people now, since I started to talk about it. This is Jan Pulkrábek. He will be the Minister of Finance for now. He is a libertarian. He is already in private, public, corporate finance for more than 10 years. This is Jan Příhoňský. He will be the Minister of Interior. Also studied this topic on Charles University and was already a security manager in a couple of companies. This is my head of office, if you write to secretary@liberland.org. This is Monika. She is actually daughter of one of our ambassadors in Czech Republic, so she's a very skilled diplomat. And I will also announce the other people, but it will take another week or so, so you have to wait for it. And the situation now is that we are the only country that runs land registry for this piece of land. If you look into Croatia or Serbia land registry, you will not find it. If you go to il/liberland.org, you will see a functional land registry. If you look into Croatia land registry, this is how the situation looks like. You can see that there is actually a preparation for borders between Croatia and Liberland. If you look into Serbia land registry, then of course that dotted line is the end of their land registry. This was by definition no man's land. It was a part of a 24-year ongoing border dispute, but within this dispute, this piece of land was never claimed by Croatia or Serbia. And the situation with the citizenship is that we now have 382,000 already, as I checked, people who registered on the website, and 73,000 people who applied for citizenship. If we accepted everybody, we would be six times more populated than the highest populated place on Earth, Macau. We don't want to have that, actually. So we will be quite picky. We will pick the people who, of course, will add value to Liberland, who will share our values, which is a belief, libertarian belief, basically, and who are serious about getting this new country started. And you can see that many of these people come from Middle East, but a part of that, there is some 60% of people that come from all around the world. And it's quite nice because we have people who applied for citizenship even from places like Nauru, Vanuatu, Tuvalu. It's crazy. People from all around the world somehow got to know about Liberland. So here in Poland, if I'm right, yes, it was almost 6,000 people registered from here. And I'm running around the world to make sure that we always choose the best person to represent us in each country. I think Fior is doing a great job. Mr. Parkita is also doing a good job. So thank you, guys. I will officially nominate you to represent us here. Now we have 52 other representatives around the world, most of the world now. And I'm very happy to announce that we also have a person for Russia, starting yesterday, which was one of my biggest concerns, that we, despite the fact there is 6,000 people from Russia, we couldn't get somebody to represent us there who would share our values and would be well connected. In places, for example, like Slovakia, we have a person who is our fan, is Richard Sulík, former head of the parliament and now member of European Parliament. I spoke personally with a number of senators and congressmen from all around the world. We have now more than 10 political parties that support our cause, which I don't think that any other country has political parties abroad. Some of them are smaller, some of them are larger. I would like to make some big connections now in United Kingdom and in United States. So wish me luck in that. Of course, getting connected with a political party is two-sided. On the one side, you have a very strong organization there, but on the other side, it polarizes your supporters. So sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not that good idea to get connected. I like to join people, not to take them apart. And also, it's kind of funny that, for example, in United Kingdom, there is lots of people from Labour Party, which I wouldn't expect, and I was interested, how is it possible? And they say, you know, we would like to have a socialism at home, but why don't we try Liberland? It might be a good idea. So even those people, they believe in socialism, but they would like to experiment, and they understand that liberty brings prosperity. So this is very likely our future foreign minister, Juan Pina, who is the head of Libertarian Party in Spain. They are quite small, but very well organized. I hope he will lead our mission, diplomatic mission, in following month. This is my friend in Swiss Parliament, where I went for a visit 2 months ago. He introduced me to most of the people from the foreign committee there. So it's also crucial for us, support from Swiss nation, because they are very close to us in terms of national belief. This is, of course, a very special connection here in Poland. Here we haven't made any official connection here. We do not count them to the political parties that directly support us, but of course, we already met twice. And I think there are many things that we share with Mr. Corwin. What we want to do now is there is a strong push for company registry. Everybody wants to move their company into Liberland. And we said, okay, you know, but if we are doing it, we are not going to do it like ordinary land registry. We will make it very user-friendly to register your company in Liberland. And we will connect those things which people now take almost for granted. You will be able to use it also for payments. You will be able to use it for Bitcoin payments as well. You will be able to show your GPS position anywhere in the world you are, and you will be able to connect it with your business, which is also very easy to program now. And we will be also able to offer any kind of rental of any property that you have, car or house or something. So there will be a big social gathering. I think it will help us to socialize our nation and also will promote Liberlandian ideas, a voluntary exchange ideas all around the world. So you might end up going to New York and you just pick the cafe because it is run by somebody who registered in Liberland, right? Why not? Or you would like to take a taxi and you will also pick up, you will not go for Uber, you might just look up if somebody is providing from Liberland that service. And you know that there is something more than just business that connects you together. We want to make a very strong also reputational thing connected to all the businesses so people can see how well are these companies behaving, or if the others have had a good experience with it. And I already explained you a little bit about constitution, a little bit about legislative process, but let me go over it again because I think it's important to understand what we have combined together. So the cabinet of 5 ministers will send a bill to assembly. And if people would like to get this, if the members of assembly would like to have it passed, they have to collect 15 out of 20 votes. Then the Supreme Court will check the constitutionality. And then there is this very strong, very important aspect that the citizens will have ability to veto any law that they don't like. This is the Swiss model democracy, which I think has proven to be very good. We also, for example, took from the Swiss model fact that the country cannot make any debts. In Czech Republic, we now, for example, pay more to pay back the debt and the interest than we pay for education. And the constitution would be very easy to read, very short. It is actually, if you read the first two pages, it says state should take care only of these three basic things that I mentioned, and nothing apart of that, but it follows that just to make sure that the things don't happen like in past, we will also mention what it shouldn't do. And then the 26 pages of different bans on government follow. And for example, state will not be able to make any laws on marriage in Liberland. So there will be no gay marriage debate. And I quite like that aspect. You know, why should state do any laws on marriage? Why cannot church take care of that? Or any private entity that you choose? There will be no possibility to make laws on public education or public healthcare system. We believe that state usually doesn't do too much good in these topics. And this is funny, like many people tell me, what the hell happened when somebody gets sick? And I'm telling you that the Liberland will be one of the medical tourist destination of the world. We already have like 10 clinics that want to move over right away. But people still don't understand that, you know, without state, they believe there will be no healthcare. And also, it's the same with education. We believe that there is no business of state in that field. That we can, with the responsible society, we can have a people should take care of their education as well as of their health themselves. Just to give you a little bit of an idea what we are now planning on the spot, this is a house right next to Liberland on Serbia side of the river. This is a house on Croatia side of the river, right next to Liberland as well. They are not expensive, we are going to buy them now. So we have a permanent base next to it. And what we want to also do is settle Liberland itself with something fancy. So we are making now a connection with these Slovakian architects that makes sustainable units. And some of the private investors would like to have their first homes in Liberland. So this is one of the options, for example, Eco Capsule, which doesn't need any connection to anything, and you can live in it with unlimited time. We now have also some time schedule of what we want to achieve, and many people believe that Liberland can be done over the summer holidays. That would be nice, but not Rome wasn't built in a day, so Liberland will not be built over summer holidays. Of course, it's a large diplomatic effort. And we believe that we will need this following year to organize ourselves, to structure the government, to structure our diplomatic bodies all around the world. So we can talk about territorial control in 2017. There will be a couple of events in the following year. You are very welcome to visit Liberland. We will probably help with creating a couple of festivals there. We will outreach for local authorities, cooperate again on cultural events, maybe make an educational center right next to Liberland. So there will be all these types of activities. But we believe we need another year, following year, to take over the territorial control. Because what that means is that we have to actually have a police, functional police in the territory. And now Croatia is taking care of that. They don't allow anybody to pass in. But this has to be, of course, our responsibility. We're quite grateful for them for that. Anyway, if they said this is part of Croatia, that would, of course, make our job much harder. But if they put border police around the territory, that makes our life much more easier and we save a lot of money. And we will probably have to compensate them for that in future. We would like to have general elections, so we will have enough citizens. So we would like to have a stable government coming out of that election and an infrastructure development already started. We would like to, in the following years, start memberships in international organization and start making international treaties. And we would really like to attract some of those investments. Now, you wouldn't believe, but the amount of investment that people pledge and we think is realistic for the project so far is $20 billion. This is what the people wrote into the columns, but it's much less than actually they wrote. This is something that we think is realistic out of the people that applied for the project. There are now 520 people that earn more than $1 million a year that applied for the citizenship that want to make Liberland happen. So I hope to get a couple of these people on board to allow us expand our diplomatic team to speed up the process of recognition, for example. By 2020, we would like to have 150 fully functional embassies around the world and also have a large budget surplus. We think that the citizenship applications can generate revenues. We think that the rental of the land can also generate revenues. So this target is achievable. And by 2025, we would like to have 30 to 50,000 residents and have something like $130 million budget surplus and have already almost $1 billion of investment into the country. And in future, we would like to be the most libertarian and developed country in the world. We would like to be actually providing energy to the surrounding areas because making a power plant in Liberland will be much easier than elsewhere. And we would like to have cutting edge infrastructure, something that people can say, wow, you know, this is how the futuristic city will look like. And if you've seen Tomorrow's Land, it was funny because it was in movie some month after we started the country. So I was like, yeah, they are making a movie about us. That is nice. So I recommend you. It's a nice movie, Tomorrowland. So this is about it from me. I would be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Okay. Okay. So if you want to ask question, now is the time. Okay.
Just let me stress one thing. You don't know it maybe, but you are now present at the event which is establishing our presence in Poland. So we are establishing future embassy. That means if you want to get involved anyhow with Liberland, please contact Jan Fior or Mr. Parkita or here. So we can get engaged in the future and we saw each other for the first time here. So and it's a lot of work. We need to get in touch with all political parties, with all embassies. We need to explain our ideas basically to whole electorate body here.
Okay, so I'm just curious. Haven't you considered like at all doing some kind of modern monarchy instead of this type of republic?
Actually, I would like to retire after we get Liberland going. I might maybe start doing something else. Maybe, I don't know. I don't know yet, but I think when we get Liberland going, I will need to have some bit of a rest for a couple of years. So I'm not too much into monarchy, and it has never been my primary objective to rule the world. So I just wanted, you know, my primary idea was always to bring a little bit more freedom to the world. And you might feel frustrated when you are campaigning for 5 years in Czech Republic, and then finally you have one member of European Parliament, and then you find out that even if you had 20 members of European Parliament, it wouldn't change a thing on the political spectrum. And then when former member of the secret police in Czech Republic wins the election, then you basically have no other option than to set up your own country, because you feel depressed that it's very hard to change things. You might have a different experience here in Poland, I don't know if you do, but of course, and everybody told me, you know, you should set up your own state to prove your, that your ideas are right. So I did it, right? So it's.
David, what are your plans regarding gun allowance for the citizens?
Pardon?
Guns. Allowance.
Yes, okay. Guns. This is one of the most controversial part of the of our constitution. It allows to carry and to manufacture any type of small arms without any restrictions. And of course, this is always the topic of our legal experts. They say you will never get recognized if you have this paragraph, because then, of course, it will be like a heaven for small arms. I think we are able to keep it there for quite some time. We will have to, of course, make compromises. And Liberland is about creating a country with minimum possible regulations that are needed to get country recognized. And this is, of course, about finding that borderline. This might be behind that borderline already. Okay.
All right, I have a question about, I'm very curious because I see this logo first time, and I'm curious about what's the meaning of you. I see a bird, sun and tree, and maybe it's not about politics and this topic, but I'm curious about it.
That's a tree of abundance, an apple tree. In Liberland Times, we have already a newspaper print version. They say that this is a symbol that I'm actually Illuminati, and they said this is a Kabbalah symbolism behind it. So they calculated all the apples, and they said this is some mystery in there. I don't really know about it. But then there is Danube River that we have there. Actually, the flag, we had the flag before we decided to go to Liberland. So now it's Danube River, the bird of liberty, and the sun. For the fact that we are shiny, happy people, and this is very positive project because this is the only way how to make this such a crazy idea happen. You cannot fight anybody, you know. You cannot. This is something that I have done in Czech Republic. For 5 years, I've been fighting all these socialists and so on. Now we are running positively. We are only putting up our vision of how things should work. And if we have some obstacles, we always use them in our favor, which is very important, because then you basically have no obstacles if you are able to turn all the obstacles into your favor. So sun is there for the fact that we are a positive project.
Okay, Vít, I have a question.
Yes.
Who will build the road?
that's the typical one. But that's the funny thing, usually the French guys ask that, and I'm asking them, you know, who is running your highways anyway? They have socialist country with private highways. The infrastructure, especially in smaller place like Liberland, will be just a very small part of the overall budget for the development of the country. And already in Prague, there are whole parts of the city when there is no involvement of state into roads. It's funny. And they don't bother to deal with state because there is so much bureaucracy. They rather build a road and then possibly give it later to the state because they have to. Or they are making the payments and parks and everything. So I think that's not an issue. And who is building the roads anyway now? Is it the state? No. Maybe in some Ghana or somewhere they buy the machines and so on. But it's the private companies. And we don't have very good experience in Czech Republic. Our highways in Czech Republic are almost most expensive highways in the whole world. We build them even more expensive. Are yours? Yes. I knew that somebody is beating us. but we are. I think we are competing. So they are probably 5-6 times more expensive than they should be. But you know, it's the state taking care of that. So it's easy to explain.
Okay, Mr. Jelitska, thank you very much. I was touched before when you mentioned Juan Pina from Spain, because I am a member of the Spanish Libertarian Party.
Are you? Oh, that's good.
And I'm a very close and personal friend of Juan Pina. Uh-huh. And I was the first candidate for for the elections, the first elections that Juan Parte, Libertarian Party in Spain, ran for like 4 years. I was candidate for the presidency of the government. So I'm I'm very specially linked to the party, and I was very touched about this mention to Juan Pina, who's an excellent person and a bright mind. Yes, but I have to say two things. First, because these people here are all very, very young, and after I'm 47, after spending my life, you know, looking for an alternative to a socialist way of living, and then suddenly you came up a few months ago, you cannot imagine what was the impact on me in terms of hope and in terms of dreaming. So you took that responsibility, and I just encourage you to take it to the very end. But many, many people were just hoping that you really have success. My little boy, who's 7 years old, last week, it was the Independence Day in Poland, and he said that it's cool. He, instead of drawing, painting the flag of Poland, he painted the flag of Liberland. So, so imagine what is the meaning for in my family of your thing. So just to ask you, what if you have to convince somebody to put his money in, you know, in helping Liberland? What is the key thing that you would tell him to convince him? You know, because in the end, it's you have to take a stake, which is to send money, and then what is the what are the real chances to make all this come true?
Well, first of all, I think Liberland has a great value in itself. We have built our largest libertarian network. Maybe we are competing a little bit with Students for Liberty, but largest libertarian network in the world. Just being part of that community has a great value. And we will make sure that the community will grow and it will interact with one another for its own benefit. It's like the Jews spreading all around the world, making the connections, taking over the world, and so on. And the second thing, it's about crowdfunding, basically. We need a lot of people who put little money, a little. Of course, building a new nation is not a very cheap thing. We will need a lot of energy put into the project so the other nations will take us seriously. But when 300,000, 400,000 people would send $10 to the project, then of course we wouldn't have to worry about financing for another 3 years. Unfortunately, that's not the case. And one of the reasons why it's not happening is that we are always having some technical difficulties with payments. So it was first PayPal who told us, sorry, sir, we respect your Liberland, but we cannot help you with your nation building effort anymore. So they blocked most of the money in the early month, which was quite uncomfortable anyway, because they couldn't fit us into any box, right? We were building a country. I actually registered it as a country with PayPal. And I actually think that they recognized us. You know, they were. But I think they kept the flow of financing much longer than they would do it otherwise with the company, because they were not under some regulatory framework with companies and fundraising money. We were fundraising money for a new country. But then they told us, we cannot do business with you anymore, because maybe somebody from somewhere told them, you know, stop, cut it. And now we have a little bit of problems with credit cards, but I hope it's solved. Now it's working, especially in Europe. I can tell that it's working, so people can again help us send the money. And of course, we are also looking for investment. If you would like to help us, for example, buy the property around Liberland, those houses, you are very welcome to co-invest any kind of money, and you are not giving the money out. And many other countries do it as well, anyway. If you want to have a citizenship of Kitten Nevis, then you have to invest $250,000. You can buy citizenship of United Kingdom anyway. Do you know about it? Try to guess how much does it cost. It's £1 million. So citizenship is like a membership, basically, right? And those countries, those nations, are quite elite clubs. They value themselves. They allow some other members to travel to their country or not to travel to their country. And we have gotten so far that there are many people now who share our belief, but also they want to get Liberlandian passport because they feel it's much more prestigious than their Afghani or Pakistani passport. And they know that they will not be able to travel with it for a couple of years now. But they still think that it will better maybe business relations and so on. So yes, we are prestigious club. People who donate considerable amount of energy will get passports. We will start issue them beginning January, at the end of January actually. And you can become part of this project if you help it a little bit. That's it. And it's up to you how much you want to help it.
Okay, so among all those interesting ideas that you mentioned during your speech, because of course Liberland is, for any libertarian, I think it's like a beacon of hope, we might call it. There was one about the whole urban plan that you are planning very much ahead, which I think is also a great idea to have everything planned, especially that the land is not unlimited. It's only, as far as I know, 7 square kilometers. I was wondering if you could tell us more about this architectural contest that you have there. Mm-hmm. So is it restricted in any way as to whom could apply with their ideas and projects? Does it have to be an architect or maybe generally?
It can
who can apply and
who has any type of expertise in that? If you have never done such a thing, then of course it might not be the best project for you, but maybe you can learn it. This is the great thing about Liberland, right? The restrictions on, for example, opening up your medical practice or opening up your architectural studio will not be much. People will judge according to your performance how much you are actually skilled to do that. And my friend in Czech Republic, she just found out she has to study an extra 5 years to be a technician dentist, or like she's only helping dentist. She now has to study extra 5 years because somebody in the government decided that these technicians now have to study extra 5 years, not only 1 or 2 years that they have done previously. So she now, instead of continuing doing her job that she has already done for 5 years, she now has to go back to school, which makes no sense whatsoever. So even I think architects, if you are skilled enough, you will be able to work as an architect. The other question is if somebody will certify you or not in Liberland, some private organization. And of course, we don't care. You can be whatever gardener, and you can help us have some ideas how Liberland can be developed. And there are very basic ideas what should be there. If I look back at the map, we would like to have airport. Small airport there, and there is already a plane field here where small planes can already land, but maybe we might enlarge it so we have an international airport. But there is also other option that we will help develop an airport, an old military airport, which is somewhere over here in Serbia, and we would like to have port here, possibly here or here, so we can use Danube River, which is a great waterway, and lots of goods are already transported there, so we can use the tax-free zone to make business in the area. And anyway, there is already an idea by Serbia to make tax-free zone in this area. So we are quite in line with the general policy of what Serbia is planning.
I'd like to ask about your worry plate. I mean, what are the main risks for this project from your point of view, and what do you do to mitigate them?
Risks. Well, for example, now I made sure that even if something happens to me, then the project will go on, which is very important. So that, of course, lowers the risk that somebody will shoot me or something. And that means that I'll give you a little bit more background. Like every single entity nowadays starts with some sort of corporation behind it. So even European Union started as a corporation in London before it got running. So we now, Liberland is now run by Liberland Limited, which is situated in Hong Kong. It's in tax-free zone, its accounts are in Liechtenstein, so it's like the best setup that we could think of to have some sort of entity which can make deals with other governments even before it gets recognized by other countries. So, yes, we are now working to mitigate these kind of risks, tax-related risks, injury-related risks, and so on. But I'm not generally afraid about any particular thing. I think we are going right direction. I wish we were a little bit faster, but some of the things just take time.
I have to say that it is really a pleasure to meet you tonight. And I think this is a great plan for the future. But aren't you a little afraid that maybe in 20 years, your country is gonna evolve into something what you haven't planned, and it won't be so free as it should be?
Well, the United States were quite free for more than 200 years or something around that. I think it was a great job that Thomas Jefferson and the company did in the early days. I think we are able to make better constitution now with all this expertise, and somebody makes fun of it and we are creating it for 1,000 years. Now, I don't think it's going to be that long. It might be 300 years maybe, but I believe when the structure is properly set up and the nation is very homogeneous in its belief, it takes a couple of generations to disassemble the constitution and to make the whole thing fall apart.
Do you have any plans to, of course, peacefully enlarge Liberland?
Well, that's one of the things, like, people asking me, you know, what we're gonna do if we will have too many people there. And of course, making Liberland nearby or taking some of the territory is one of the options, which might be actually easier than to try to build higher skyscraper. And we already have one territory, and it's a little funny story because I helped to develop marketing for Kingdom of Northern Sudan. Have you heard about it? They were the first country to recognize us. They recognized us like 1 minute after we started Liberland, which was helpful because a lot of the media wrote, you know, Northern Sudan already recognizes Liberland and it's great, and you can see the quality of journalism all around the world. Nobody is able to check what kind of state is Northern Sudan. But it's a bit complicated in a sense that I helped to develop marketing strategy for this country. I did some PR videos because this was one of my previous businesses. I did PR videos for libertarian ideas and think tanks. And he didn't pay me for it. I don't know why, he just didn't honor his debts, and now he is claiming 3,000 kilometers square between Egypt and Sudan. He is the only one claiming it, but he owes me personally $5,000. So we might actually make some exchange. and there is another great thing. I don't know if you saw the picture with the number of applicants. It was here. Yeah, number one, Egypt, 82,000 people. I'm not sending them mail, actually. This is one of the things I'm worried about. So when we send the mass mail, we are not sending it to Egypt and these countries yet, because we don't want to make some sort of revolution in Egypt. But if we might have it. It's like a plan B, of course, that... I don't think there is any political party which has so many supporters in Egypt that would have so many registration. I didn't go there yet. I went to Turkey. I'm a rock star there. If I go there 500 people come for the meeting and all the media come down there because it was very popular in all the social media and also mainstream media. Like when I was there last time, basically all the television and all the newspapers wrote about my visit to country, which was very encouraging. So yes, no, Northern Sudan is one of the options, immediate options for moving our ideas. And also I can tell that we are very well connected to some rich individuals in Egypt, so I hope to cooperate them on making Liberland more widespread.
Do you want to cooperate with the breakaway with Transnistria and Nagorno-Karabakh? The breakaway state, do you want to cooperate with them?
I'm not commenting on that issue yet. Our foreign policy is not determined yet on these states.
Okay, so three more questions, okay?
Dobrý den. Zkusím to česky. Zaprvé děkuju, že jste se tady objevil. Aha. To je první věc. A druhá věc je, proč jste si právě vybral Polsko? Já budu mluvit teraz po polsku, že poděkovávám i chtěl zapytat, dlaczego pan Jelička vlastně vybral Polskę jako pierwsze państwo, które odwiedził. Ja akurat jestem Czechem żyjącym tutaj w Warszawie i jakby podzielam tego typu polityczne i ogólne życiowe podejście i bardzo się cieszę, bo naprawdę coś to dla mnie znaczy.
Tak, I already said, of course, Poland is close to me as a Czech guy and also as a Liberlandian, and the support from here is enormous. And I came here because I got invitation to speak here, and when I went here, I already knew there are other organizations that want to make event with me. So it actually took me quite long to get here. I already visited 37 countries before I went to Poland, so I'm sorry for that. It's a big, in some of the places I have been already a number of times, and I had to come back because there were important personal meetings. But finally, I'm in Poland, so it's great to be here. And it's actually one of the last countries that I'm going to visit this year. I need to work a little bit on organization base. And now on other things than traveling around. I'm going to Saudi Arabia next week and London again, but probably that will be about it for the rest of the year.
Hi, I'd like to ask you, how would you like to manage the self-dependency of the land itself, as you've already told, you're so far dependent on Croatian policy to yes. Protect the borders, and the financial self-dependency is also a problem, as you're already depending so far on other currencies and other financial companies, institutions. So how far do you want to go with your own self-dependency? And as you've already mentioned, the Serbia old military airport, huh. How far could you go with self-dependency of the country, and what, in which places, in which cases would you be forced to cooperate and be dependent on other surrounding areas?
We will have to pay protection fee, just like Monaco does. To France, for example. And yes, we will probably have to tax Croatian citizens, so Croatia government is happy about it. It's just like France with Monaco again. I don't know how popular will they be with that, but yes, we are ready to do that. There are some things that we have to compromise on. And probably part of the protection fee will have to go to Serbia as well. So yes, we are not going to build an army. Central bank, yes. This is the touchy issue.
Yes, it's speaking so funny. Of,
I will just finish it. You know, this is the touchy issue. Always, like I was always against central banking and so on. But on the other hand, I also studied central banking. It was one of my major theses. And it's creating money out of thin air is so much fun, you wouldn't believe. And it works great. If there is a great demand for your currency, you're actually getting money for, just take a look at Switzerland, right? They're accumulating billions of euros. And if they were not stupid, they would keep on accumulating them and use them to, for example, to acquire some property that could make them money and so on. But they are not doing that. China, for example, does that. They use their currency reserves to buy Singapore Telecom and so on. Because there is a great demand for the currency, and then they are making money out of thin air, and they are using it to buy real assets. So I'm not too much against central bank as itself, but there will be always absolute currency freedom in Liberland. Government will never tell anybody what currency it should use or not. But to be honest, currency is one of the state symbols, basically, just like flag, just like anything else. It shows how much trust there is in the country, and it might not be that bad idea to come up with a currency. And now we have this merit system, which is basically the base for the currency. And the currency is created whenever you send any type of donation. When you use now credit card, it pops up right on your account, just like with PayPal. So we are creating this currency out of thin air, but it's generated only when people deliver some value to Liberland.
Speaking of peacefully enlarging the territory of Liberland, have you ever considered the possibility of asking all those people who apply for citizenship to declare their own land in their countries a part of Liberland? Have you ever thought about it?
Because
Liberland could become quite an empire.
Of course, this is the cool thing that anybody who has internet connection can apply for citizenship. And I told to the Swiss media that we can one day be the largest nation in the world. Of course we can. Everybody who has internet, even the Chinese, can apply for citizenship and they can get it. So we are very slow on giving out the citizenship so far. I only gave it to people who I knew for quite a long and who came down to Liberland and who helped Liberland somehow significantly. But now we are making this process transparent. Whoever accumulates enough merits can basically buy a share in Liberland, which gives him a voting right. So it is a kind of corporation now, the structure, but it's not too different from other states, right? You will be basically a shareholder as you are, as any type of citizen in any other country. And when you collect enough of these merits, enough of these shares of the country, enough of the future currency, you will get like a master share, which will give you voting right and give you a passport.
Okay, so Vít, thank you.
Thank you very much. Should I go there? Okay. Should I go there or
wait? Wait after applause.
Thank you again, everybody who has come.
ASBIRO, alternatywna szkoła biznesu i rozwoju osobowego.